How worried should you be when something gets slapped with the label probably causes cancer? It's a classification that makes for easy headlines, as chemicals that were previously thought to be not so bad are outed as seemingly potential killers. Yet as we'll see, just because something might cause cancer doesn't mean that it necessarily will. One of the more prominent organizations that evaluate carcinogens is the International Agency for Research on Cancer, or IARC for short. IARC publishes doorstop-sized reports, they call them monographs, that evaluate the evidence for or against something having the ability to cause cancer. These monographs are the culmination of a long and arduous process. Leading experts huddle together for days at a time and carefully sift through publicly available data. They look at whether there's evidence for a specific agent causing cancer in people. They look to see if there's any evidence for it causing cancer in animals. They examine whether there are scientific reasons to think it might cause cancer. And they weigh the evidence, which is rarely black and white, to determine whether on balance there's a chance that the agent could cause cancer given the right circumstances. At the end of this process, the substance or agent under examination is given a number from 1 to 4. First, there are the Group 1 substances. These are the bad actors where the data are pretty clear that exposure to enough of them could lead to cancer. At the other end of the spectrum, there's Group 4. This is where they put the stuff where the balance of evidence suggests that they don't cause cancer. Just above this is Group 3. Here you'll find substances where there just isn't enough evidence to indicate that they are carcinogenic. And then there's Group 2. Group 2 is the tricky one. These are the substances where there are hints that they might cause cancer, but the data aren't conclusive. Group 2 is divided into probable carcinogens and possible carcinogens. If there's evidence that a substance can cause cancer in animals, but the jury's out on humans, it's likely to be labelled as a possible carcinogen and placed into Group 2B. On the other hand, if the data on cancer in humans is just a little stronger, but still not conclusive, the substance is likely to be put in Group 2A and labelled a probable carcinogen. In effect, ending up in Group 2 is the equivalent of IARC slapping a take care label on something. They're letting you know that under some circumstances, if you're exposed to enough of the stuff, you might get cancer. Plenty of common substances end up with this take care label. Eat fried food, for instance, and you're probably ingesting acrylamide, an IARC probable carcinogen. Spray your weeds with the herbicide Roundup, and you're using the IARC labeled probable carcinogen, glyphosate. Interestingly, working as a hairdresser and working shifts that disrupt your body's rhythms are also both listed as probable carcinogens. Then there's coffee, gasoline, and, wait for it, pickled vegetables. Each of these are listed by IARC as potential carcinogens. In effect, an IARC label indicating something is a potential or a probable carcinogen doesn't mean that it will necessarily cause cancer. And it certainly doesn't mean stop using it. The label is only half the story. It suggests what could happen, but it doesn't indicate how likely it is. It's the equivalent of saying a rock could kill you, but not pointing out that it probably needs to be dropped on your head from a great height first. To make sense of these labels, additional information is needed on what probable actually means, together with how much stuff people are exposed to and how much of it is needed to cause cancer. In other words, the label alone shouldn't worry you. We're exposed all the time to substances that may cause cancer, that's unavoidable, but neither should IARC labels be taken lightly. They indicate what might be a problem. The real challenge, and this is where risk assessment comes in, is working out how to prevent that might be from turning into an is. Either by keeping exposures to safe levels, replacing the substance with something less harmful, or getting rid of it altogether. That, though, is a decision that needs more information than just the IARC assessment can provide.